Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another webinar at the National Library of Scotland. My name is Kenny Redpath, and I'm the Events Officer at the Library. Today's event is just a little bit different, as was yesterday's, in that it's a partnership event with the International Storytelling Festival. Each year, we normally do events with the festival in our library venue. However, due to the restrictions that have come into place from the pandemic, we are unable to be on site, but I'm delighted that we can still go ahead and be a small part of the wonderful Storytelling Festival. This year's festival is running from 17th to the 31st of October, and it's a programme of online events featuring Scottish and international performers, local story walks, and a community programme. For our event today, we're delighted to be joined by Tom Muir, who is giving us a talk called Tales and Traditions from Orkney. Tom is a traditional storyteller from his native Orkney Islands. Born on a small farm by the sea in Tankerness in the east of the Orkney mainland, he grew up in an environment of storytelling, of folklore and customs. He is also a founder member and president of the Orkidian Story Trust, which runs the annual Orkney Storytelling Festival, which I believe starts on Thursday at 7:30 p.m. I think, but Tom can keep me right on that. Tom's skills of storytelling have been seen him perform all over the world, and thanks to Zoom, that won't change this afternoon. Can I just say about today's talk that Tom will be sharing some of the stories from his native Orkney, which are inspired by photographs from the MacKinnon collection. And for those of you who don't know about the MacKinnon collection, this is a collection of more than 14,000 photographs documenting life in Scotland from the 1840s to the 1940s. It was recently jointly acquired by the National Library of Scotland and the National Galleries of Scotland. The collection was put together by photographer enthusiast Murray MacKinnon, and it is a truly amazing collection. But for now, over to you, Tom.
Thanks, Kenny. Quite the introduction there. I hope I live up to it. Looking forward to doing this. I was sent some photographs to look over and selected eight that have some stories relating to it. So we'll start off with this one, which is, you can see it's a staged photograph. It's a young woman grinding bare barley on a quern stone. And it's somewhere in Kirkwall. Now, grinding on a quern stone, as you can see there, you have the round circular quern stone, one sitting on top of the other. You pour the grain down through the hole in the top and you turn the handle so that you turn the top one round and round, and that grinds out your flour. But there was a story about another quern, a very special quern. Now, it happened in the days when King Frodi was the king of Denmark. A giant quern stone was found on his land, and it was called Grotti, and he had it carried back to his castle. Now, the thing is about Grotti was that it was a magic quern, and it would grind out whatever the owner wished it to. And so it was so big that nobody could turn it. Now, King Frodi went to visit his friend, the King of Sweden, and he saw that the King of Sweden had two giant women there, two giant bondmaidens, slaves, and they were of the race of giants. And he asked the King of Sweden if he would sell them one, and he agreed that he would sell both of these maidens to Frodi, and he had them carried back to his castle, where he took them to the room where the big quernstone Grotti stood, and they were set to work to grind out gold, because this was a magic quern, would grind out whatever the owner wanted. The owner wanted gold. Gold was ground out in huge quantities, flowing out to the side of the quern. Now, after Frodi had filled up his treasury, and everywhere in his castle was chock-a-block with gold, he then asked Fenya and Menya, who were the names of these two giant women, to grind out peace and plenty, fertility and happiness for the land. And Fenya and Menya set to work turning this huge quernstone between the two of them. And you couldn't see anything coming out of it. It was just nothing. But it was something. It was fortune. It was fertility. It was good luck. All the cattle had twins, and the horses and the sheep the same. The grain hung heavy on the stalks of the barley. The fruit grew on the trees so heavy it pulled the branches down. And there were so many fish in the sea that you could have practically walked from Denmark across to Norway or Sweden without getting your feet wet on the back of the fish. There was no wars, there was no strifes, there was no even any arguing. And everybody was very, very happy, except for two people, Fenya and Menya, who had to turn that huge quernstone. Well, they asked Frodi if they could get a break, a little rest every now and again. And he said, I will only let you rest for as long as the cuckoo can hold its peace, or long enough for a song to be sung. Well, they didn't like that answer, and they sang a song. And what a song it was. It was a song of hate and war, of famine and disease. And that is what they ground out of the stone Grotti. Bad luck flowed over the land. The crops failed, animals died, disease was rife, and strife was everywhere. Father and son were killing each other. Armies invaded from the south. And one night, a sea king called Mysingr sailed with his longships into the harbour of the town where Grotti lived, where Frodi lived. And they went up to the castle, and they attacked it, and they killed King Frodi. And they carried away Fenya and Menya and the quernstone Grotti. Mysingr knew what it could do as well. So he carried them off on the ship, and he ordered them to grind him salt. Now, in those days, salt was quite a valuable commodity. And he told them to grind salt. So they started to grind salt as the longships sailed westwards across the sea. Well, after a while, Fenya and Menya said, have you had enough salt yet? And he said, no, carry on grinding salt. And so they did. And the ship was swamped with salt and sank to the bottom of the sea. Now, Fenya and Menya, being of the race of giants, were immortal, and they remained at the bottom of the sea, still grinding out salt in that quernstone. And where it happened was in the Pentland Firth between Orkney and Caithness, an island there called Stroma, the island in the stream. And there's a whirlpool to the east of it called the Svelki. The Norse called it the Svelgar, the swallower, because it swallowed ships. Well, that whirlpool is caused by the circular motion of that quernstone being turned at the bottom of the sea and the water falling down through the eye in the top of the quernstone. And they still grind out salt there to this day. And that is why the sea is salt. Now we'll move on to the next picture. This is the Ring of Brodgar. Now the Ring of Brodgar is the third largest stone circle in Britain. And it's a wonderful place. There was an old story attached to it that said that this was a place where giants used to gather between the two lochs. It's on a thin strip of land between the Harry Loch and the Stennis Loch. And giants would gather there at night, and a fiddler would play, and the giants would dance. Round and round in a great circle they danced. Now the one night the fiddler was standing there playing, and the giants were dancing round and round in a great circle, and they were enjoying themselves so much that they forgot about the time. And before they realized what had happened, the sun had risen above the horizon, and they were all turned to stone. And there they remain to this day as a great circle of stones. And there's a single stone in the field next to it that they call the Comet Stone. And that was the fiddler who was playing the tune for the dance. If you don't believe me, it's still there. So you can go and check it out for yourself. Next picture, please. Now, this is Sakwai Head in Rousey. The island of Rousey is just to the north of the mainland here. And it's got some wonderful geological features around there. You can see that it's got an arch there. There's like a leg sticking into the sea. And a bit further down, there is a bit further down the coast, there are more wonderful wonderful locations as well, wonderful rock stacks. And so I was just seeing something's come up on my screen. I'm just going to switch it off. Here we go. A bit further down is a place called Scarborough Head, and that has got some wonderful rock stacks there. And in that area, there is a place called Quandle, which was a valley that was cleared in the 1840s to put sheep on it, the only big systematic clearances in Orkney. But before those days, there were people that farmed there and they fished. And there was two friends that used to go fishing together. And one night they were coming up after coming back from the fishing, and they had cases on the back, straw baskets full of fish. Now, as they were walking home, they heard music, the sound of pipes playing. So they followed it and they saw a great mound. And in the side of the mound, there was a door standing wide open with light streaming out from it. Now, the two men were curious, so they went up to the opening. Now, the one man had a knife with him because he was a fisherman. They always carried knives. And he stuck the knife above the doorway and went in, knowing that steel is a protection against any magic or any evil. And so he went in, but his friend didn't have a knife, so he was lacking steel. But the two of them went into the mound and they saw a great room in which there was a piper playing, and there was a dance going on. And who was dancing was the fairy folk. Trows, we call them in Orkney. And all these wee trows, all these wee fairies, they were all dressed in blue and white and all dancing away quite merrily. Well, the man who had stuck the knife above the door, Robbie, he said to his friend Chalk, "I think it's time we were getting out of here, Chalk." And he turned around and he pulled the knife out from above the doorway and he left. But his friend didn't have steel to protect him and he couldn't leave. Now, the next thing that Robbie knew, to his horror, the door slammed shut and there was no sign of it. He went back to his home and he gathered some of his friends and they went searching for the mound. They couldn't find the mound. Now, a year passed and Robbie was coming back from the fishing again one night and he was carrying his catch on his back. when he heard the familiar tune, the sound of pipes playing. So he followed the sound, and there was the mound. And he looked in, and there was the door open, and there was his friend Chalk still inside. He ran back to his home as quick as he could, and he fetched a second knife. And he also took a steel hoop from around a barrel that held all the staves together. And he ran back to the mound, and he drew his knife out, and he stuck it above the door, and he took out the second knife, and he stuck that above the door too. And he went into the mound, and he took the barrel hoop, and he threw it right over the top of his friend Chalk, and that broke the spell. And then the two of them were able to pull their knives out from above the door and leave the mound safely. The door slammed behind them, and they never saw it again. But Chalk, you know, he took some convincing to believe that a whole year had passed since he had gone into the mound. He thought he'd only been there for a very short period of time, just a few minutes maybe. But the fairy folk, they live outside of the time that we live in. So what can seem like a few seconds to us would be years in our lifetimes. Now, after that, I think that Robbie and Chalk were very careful not to go into mounds if they ever saw one standing there with a door open in it. But other people have said that they have done the same thing. And funnily enough, there was a story written by Washington Irvine called Rip Van Winkle about a man who had taken food with some strange looking people in ancient looking clothing. Another thing you're not supposed to do is eat fairy food. Puts you under their spell, you see. Now, he wrote the story, Rip Van Winkle, of a man who had done just that and fell asleep for 30 years. I like to think there's some connection there because Washington Irvine's father, William Irvine, came from Orkney. He came from the island of Chapensee. So who knows? There might just be a little pinch of Orkney folktale in that as well. Now, if we move on to the next picture. This is the great chamber tomb of Maeshowe. It was excavated by a man called James Farrar, who was an MP. He was a Tory MP for Durham South. He excavated it in 1861. Now, when he started work on the site, the local people warned him that he should be careful because that site was the home of a hog boy, they called it. And the hog boy, they said, possessed great strength and it could bring disaster if you annoyed him. Farrar carried on, excavated, found that he wasn't the first person to have broken into that tomb through the top. The Vikings had been there before him and had left a massive amount of graffiti carved in runes on the inside of this Stone Age tomb, 5,000 years old. But around Orkney, there are tales of Hogboy or Hogboon, as they were known in the North Isles, where my parents came from. My father came from the island of Sandy, and this is a story from not far from where he was born, really. And it's about a Hogboon, and it came from a place called Helihow, which all the names here are all Old Norse. Helihow meant the holy mound. Farmer who lived at Helihow, and he always shared the produce of the farm with the hogboon. He went to the mound outside and he would leave offerings, bread, cheese, butter, milk, ale, if they were brewing, would all be poured on the mound. And that went down to feed the hogboon who lived inside the mound. Now, the hogboon in Old Norse, hogboi, means a mound dweller. The hogboon could bring good luck to a farmer who shared the produce of the farm with them. They were attached to a family rather than a farm. And as long as you looked after the hogbone, they would look after you. You would have good luck. Everything would go fine. But if you ignored them, then that was a very different story indeed. As the man at Helihau discovered to his cost. He had married, and his wife hadn't heard of hogbones, and she thought it was a complete waste of time and money to be going out there pouring perfectly good food and drink over a mound. And so the hogbone wasn't fed. The hogbone sat inside his mound, and he waited, drumming his fingers, waiting and waiting for something to appear through the ceiling, but nothing came. He got worried. He thought, well, maybe they're ill. Maybe there's some illness has come to the house and they can't come out and feed me. So he went down in the dead of night and he sneaked in through the door and he had a little peep around to see what was going on there. And to his annoyance, everybody was sound asleep, happily tucked up in their beds, snoring away contentedly. Well, the hogbone went over to the fireplace because he thought that there would be a pot there that they made the porridge in, and they would have left some porridge in the pot for him. But when he looked in the pot, not only was there no porridge, but the pot had been scraped clean. There was nothing at all left for him. He realized then that he was being ignored. He was not being paid his due. He was not being shown the respect that he deserved. And he became angry. So he picked up the porridge pot and he headed back to his mound with it. Now in the morning, the wife at Helihau couldn't find the porridge pot. What have you done with it? She says to her husband. I haven't done anything with it. Never touched it. Well, I left it there last night and it's gone now. Well, that was only the first thing that went missing. Everything went missing after that. If she was baking bannocks and leaving them to cool on a tray, the next time she turned around, they were gone. Stolen. And the man, whenever he laid down a tool that he was using, it was gone when he turned around to pick it up again. He got fed up, so he got himself the old bamboo wand from down in the attic in the rafters of the barn. They used to use lengths of bamboo to go fishing off the rocks with in Orkney. So he took this big piece of bamboo and it had the string on it and it had hooks. And he set off down to the shore. But when he got down to the rocks to go fishing, he discovered that there were no hooks on the string. They had been taken away. They'd been removed. And when he was walking home, he could have sworn when he passed that mound that he could hear the sound of laughter coming from inside it. Now, time passed and more practical jokes were played on him, more tricks. He knew that the hogbone was behind this. His wife might not believe in him, but he did. And he decided that the only thing they could do was to move. So he went to see the laird. And he told the laird that he was having a terrible run of luck on the farm and he wanted another one. Was one available in the island? Why, yes, said the laird, you're in luck. One has just become available. It's on the other side of the island. Oh, wonderful, said the man, thinking as far away as possible, the better. So he was given the lease of this new croft, and he went home and they packed up their meagre belongings that hadn't been stolen by the hogbone, and they set off. Now, they had to borrow ponies from their neighbours, and they had clibbers on their back, pack saddles. And all their goods were packed in big baskets hung on the side of this pack saddles. And in the first saddle, and on the first horse, there was the plout kern, It was a butter churn that you would make butter in. Now, the farmer walked away from the place, and the further he went, the more relieved he became. And the further and further he walked, the happier he got, the lighter his heart was. He thought, at last, I have rid myself of this pesky hogboon. And as they walked over the brae down to where their new croft was, there it was. The larks were singing, the sun was shining, and the man was happy when suddenly the lid flew off the kern and the hogboon stuck out his head and said, "We're getting a grand day for flitting, good man." Because what the farmer had forgotten is that hogboons didn't go with the farm. They went with the family. I can only hope that he was wise enough to have fed him and looked after him after that. Next picture, please. This is Notland Castle in Westry. Now, Westry is the island where my mother came from. And this was built by a man called Gilbert Balfour in the 1560s. Now, he was meant to be kind of keeping this on behalf of the monarch. But he just kind of kept it on behalf of himself, really. But they always said he was a man with a bad conscience because it is absolutely peppered with gun loops for firing out. So he was obviously expecting trouble. He found it as well. He was implicated in the murder of Darnley and he fled Orkney, went to Sweden, and then was implicated in an attempted murder of the King of Sweden. So he was beheaded over there. Probably served them right. But anyway, he built this castle and it belonged then in the family to the Balfours for a long time after that. Under the stairs, there's a big main stair when you go in, there was a little chamber that was said to be the home of the Balky Hound, a ghost dog, a spectral hound that howled whenever a member of the Balfour family died. Now, it was said that it was last heard in Edinburgh. When a member of the family died, another member of the family heard a dog howling most piteously outside. And he actually said to his wife, a member of the family must have died. And the next day he was notified that I think it was a great aunt of his had died. But the story that I'm going to tell you about Notland Castle is none of those. It's not about death, it's about a wedding. And quite the wedding it was too. The year was 1632, and Michael Balfour's daughter, Ursula, was marrying James Fay of Clestron on the island of Eddy, another big laird. These were two big landowners whose families were being united in marriage. A lovely dress was sent away from south for the bride, salmon pink and pale green it was, which maybe sounds a bit garish to modern tastes, but it was quite the thing in 1632. Now, as the wedding was approaching, the wedding itself was to take place on Martinmas, the 11th of November. And the day before the wedding, on that evening, the traditional feet washing was carried out. Now, this was something that was done with every marriage in Orkney. The young women had their feet washed the night of the wedding. And that was done by their unmarried female friends. And so there was lots of horseplay and splashing going on. And the mother would drop a wedding ring into the tub of water, which the bride would then try to hide under her feet, and the other girls would try to find, because it meant that the person who found it would be the next to be married. Now, that was usually just done with ordinary water from the well, but not the Balfours. Oh no, they had red wine used from the foot washing. Now, the housekeeper made inquiries as to what happened to the wine. And much to her annoyance, she discovered that some of the servants in the castle had drank it. She was furious and she went to see Lady Balfour, the bride's mother, and she complained that they had stolen this wonderful, you know, this wine that was going to be used for the in the foot washing. And she said, well, it doesn't matter. I mean, why are you so upset? I mean, we couldn't use the wine again anyway. And she said, no. But the thing is, I wanted to pour it over the mound where the hogboon bides for good luck to the wedding. So the hogboon in Westry got cheated out of his wine, just like one in Sandy got cheated out of his food. The servants protested when they asked them that they didn't drink it because they wanted the alcohol. They drank it for love of the lady whose feet was washed in it. A likely story, eh? Anyway, all the great lairds from all over Orkney were invited to this wedding. It was going to be a sumptuous feast. And they arrived, hungry as locusts, and they all piled into the great hall upstairs in the castle. There was wonderful food laid on, oceans of drink, and the dancing started. And that night, as the dancing was going on and on and on, it was noticed that the wind outside was rising. It was blowing hard around the walls of the castle. It was howling there around the towers. This just added to the sport. They thought that this was wonderful, the howling, raging gale outside while they were inside, warm and happy and cozy and dancing and eating and drinking, having a great time. Now, that was all very well. The party went on late into the night, and the next day when they got up, the wind was still blowing. Now, all of these people had arrived by boat. There was no way that the boats could sail on weather like that. That would be suicide. So they had to stay. Ah, you're welcome, said Michael Balfour. And so more food was prepared and more drink, and the dancing carried on, and it went through that second day and the third day and the fourth. It went through all that week and the following week and the week after that. Now, that week's turned into a month. Then it turned into 2 months. Remember, this was the 11th of November. They were heading towards Christmas, and they still had a castle full of guests. The wind was still howling. There was nothing that they could do. Some of them tried to play football and golf around the castle, but it would have been depending on the weather. And from what they were saying, the wind was up and the sea was up as well, so they couldn't sail. Christmas came and went, New Year came and went, and still there was no sign of the wind abating. And still, these people had to be fed. Legend has it that a cow was killed and quartered. And one quarter would be roasted the one day to feed the guests. Another quarter would be boiled on the second day. And then that was repeated again. And then on the fifth day, they would have a roast sheep, and then on the day after that, a boiled sheep. And then they would start with another cow being slaughtered. Now, his sheep was getting greatly diminished, but so was his cattle. There were far fewer cattle than there was sheep. And the poor old cows, the milk cows, all the young ones had been slaughtered. And then it started on the milk cows themselves. They were all killed as well. And the sheep were running very, very low. Now, all the poultry they had, the ducks and the hay and the geese, they were all eaten a while before. And the one servant came to Michael Balfour the one day, and he said, "The only thing that we've got left in the byre was the bowl." "Well, he'll have to go as well," said the laird. And so the bull was slaughtered, and he was quartered, and again roasted and boiled. And when it came to Candlemas Eve, the evening, I should say, of Candlemas, the 2nd of February, he said, "Well, I don't know what I'm going to give my guests tomorrow, because they've eaten everything. They've eaten the last of the bull, stoop and rope," which just means like every bit of it. But the next day, the wind miraculously went down, and they were able to take to their boats and to go home. Now, in case it seems a bit unlikely that you had a wedding going for over 3 months, the wind can be pretty unpredictable up here. And the fact that William Balfour then had to sell a lot of his land just in the aftermath of that is probably proof that that really did happen. Next picture, please. Now, this isn't actually in Orkney. I came across this, the Orkneyman's Cave at Bressy in Shetland. Now, I didn't know a story about this, so I consulted my friend Professor Google, and Professor Google gave me the story. So thank you. There was an Orkneyman who lived in Shetland. Now, this was at the time of the press gang, when the press gang would be rounding up young men, and they would be impressed into the Navy. So they would have to serve on the king's ships in one of the numerous wars that the kings always started up, usually with the French. Now, Orkney sailors were never keen on going into the Royal Navy because your life expectancy was not good. And it wasn't because of the battles. It was because of the conditions on the ship, the hardships, the floggings. It was not a good place to be. Now, the press gang got after this young Orkneyman, and he set off in a boat and he sailed into this cave, and he got in and he managed to get up onto a ledge at the back of the cave. But then there was a sudden surge of water that came in through the cave, and he hadn't securely tied up his boat, and the boat came loose and was pulled away and drifted out of the cave, leaving the young man stranded on the ledge at the back. And then, to make matters worse, a gale blew up, a great storm raged, and the sea was ferocious. And the young Orkneyman had to stand on that ledge there for 2 whole days, waiting for the wind to go down. And when eventually the wind did go down on the third day, he was able to jump into the sea and to swim over to a rock in the sea. And from the rock, he was able to scramble up the cliff and climb up the cliff to safety. So, rather him than me. Next picture, please. Now, this is taken at cliff on the west side of the island of Westry. And the man in the photograph with looks like a giant butterfly net, he is swapping for axe. Now, that means that he was catching orcs, which nymphs, and they would be flying past and he would catch them in the net, and they would be used as a supplement for their diet, which was fairly meager. Now, catching orcs on the cliffs there, obviously, it doesn't happen now. There is no great desire for it, and it's illegal anyway, even if you did want to do it. But there is a wonderful but tragic story from the neighbouring island of Papa Westry, which has a cliff called the Foul Crag. Now it's at the north end of the island. The island rises up to the north and there's tall cliffs. And it was the last nesting place in Britain of the Great Auk. Now in 1812, there were just these two Great Auks, this breeding couple that would come and nest on the cliffs at Foul Crag. Now, they were a large auk, like a small penguin, and flightless. They had tiny little stunted wings, were very clumsy on land, but in the sea, their ability to swim was something to behold. Now, the laird who lived on the island, the Trail was his name, in Holland House, he heard about these auks, known to the local folk as the King and the Queen of the Auks. So the King and Queen of the Auks. And he was a bit of a naturalist, and so he wanted these two last remaining auks, the last of their species, to breed in Britain. Not in the world, but in Britain. He wanted them killed so that he could skin them and send the skin to the Natural History Museum in London. Now, he had offered a bounty for the killing of these birds. Now, the female auk was on her egg. They laid one egg and she was incubating it. And people are able to crawl across to the cliff top. And then they killed her by stoning her to death. And the body was brought back to the laird, who was delighted. He skinned it. It was sold to the Natural History Museum. And it was stuffed and put on display there. And I believe it's still on display there to this day. Now, the male was too wily or too cautious, too timid. He didn't come ashore if he could get off with it. They lived on the sea. They only came ashore to breed and they mate for life. Now, they weren't able to get him, but the following year in 1813, he arrived back at the same nesting site, probably looking for his mate. But he was always too cautious. He kept out on the sea. They couldn't catch him. But one day, there was one of the local crofters had been out, and he'd been out shooting as well, shooting auks off the cliff. And he came around the corner of a rock and he saw the King of the Auks on the sea. And he shot him and killed him. And he was given to the laird. He received his bounty for it. The laird sold it for a great sum to the Natural History Museum. And it would have been nice to be able to say that they were placed together, but they weren't, because his skin was too badly damaged. And so his skin ended up in a drawer in the Natural History Museum and was never reunited with his mate again. Tragic story. I did warn you. Now, our last slide of this little fest is the Italian chapel, which probably some of you know. It's a beautiful, beautiful little church made from two Nissen huts in World War II by Italian prisoners of war who were working on the construction of the Churchill barriers. And the main artist behind it was a wonderful man called Domenico Chiacchetti, who did all that beautiful painting you can see there, and a wonderful altarpiece that shows the Virgin Mary with the Christ child on her lap, and the Christ child is holding an olive branch as a sign of peace. The whole chapel was dedicated to peace. Now, another man, Giuseppe Palumbi, he made that wonderful wrought iron rood screen that you can see there, all that metal work. Now, there is a beautiful story attached to him, which we didn't know until a few years ago, and there was a man called Philip Paris, came here with his wife Catherine for their honeymoon, and he came to the chapel and it moved him so much, he wanted to find out more about it. And he got the story from Giuseppe Palumbi's son. And Palumbi had fallen in love with an Orkney girl. This was not allowed. They were not allowed to fraternize with the local women. Of course it happened, but they weren't officially meant to. And when he had came to be sent away again in 1944, they were sent down to Shipton in Yorkshire. He told this woman that he had left a little message for her in the right in the heart of the chapel. And she had told him that when he went home, he should tell his wife about her. And she gave him a photograph of herself. And she says, tell your wife, because she will know. And she looks in your eyes, she will know something has happened. And so when he did go back to his wife and his small son, who he hadn't seen since he was a baby, the boy didn't recognize him. He told her about this woman and he showed her the photograph. She snatched it from his hands and threw it in the fire. And there was a period of coldness, not surprisingly, but they ended up having a long and happy marriage together. But he never ever forgot that woman or the chapel. And if you go in to the center of the chapel there, where those two little gates close, what stops them is a metal heart on the floor that stops the gates from just folding in. He left his heart right in the middle of the chapel.